Good morning, everyone. How are we doing this morning? Let's try that again. Good morning, everyone. How are we doing? Okay, it's a little better. Because this is awkward for me, so you're going to have to help me out here. Obviously, we got several people out today. Pastor, him and his family's on vacation, but also Jim called this morning, and Barb is not feeling well. She's sick. So let's remember them in our prayers today. Few brief announcements. This week on Wednesday, May the 4th, youth group from 6:30 to 8:30. That's grades 6 to 12. Thursday, May the 5th, ladies luncheon at the pizza place at 12 p.m. And on this coming Friday, May the 6th, broom tree from 6 to 8 p.m., and that's grades 2 through 5th. Sunday, May 15th, baccalaureate service. Is that right? Baccalaureate? Okay. Somebody who can talk better than me don't have to say that. But anyway, that service is at 2 p.m., and everyone is invited to attend and show their support. Who are the seniors that's graduating? I know Natalie's one, my daughter. Okay, Alex. Who else? And there, where's Billy at? Is Billy here? Okay, so we at least got several. So everyone's welcome to come and attend that. Sunday, May the 22nd, we have a guest speaker. It's named Kenny Evans, and I believe he sings, and I think is what Pastor was saying. But and today, obviously, like I said earlier, the pastor's not here. So we welcome Pastor Phil Mollohan. Is that close? Okay. And he is a longtime friend of Pastor John. So thanks for being here today. We appreciate it. Scripture reading for today is going to be in Psalms chapter 148. It says, "Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you, waters above the heavens. Kings of all the earth, and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and maidens together, old men and children, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven. Praise the Lord." So that's what we're here to do. Everyone ready to praise the Lord today? All right, let's stand.
Let's pray. Our most gracious and kind Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in your house today. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being your children. Lord, we pray that deep in our heart we can attempt to understand the great sacrifice there was for our salvation. Lord, I pray that you would just allow us to empty ourselves, empty our hearts, take all the things of the world away from us, that we could tune our hearts into you and truly worship you this morning. We pray that you would be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted.
Exalted, the King is exalted.
on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will. The King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his. Holy, holy, to reach out and touch him and say that we love him. Open our ears, Lord, and help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him and say that we love him. Open our ears, Lord, and help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him and say that we love him. Open our ears, Lord, and help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus.
Thank you. Y'all may be seated.
Friend of Pastor John, let's give him a warm welcome.
Good morning.
Did that, all right, sounds like that's on. Good to be with you this morning and worship, and to worship with you, to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus together this morning. And so I'm glad to be here with you this morning. And yes, I am a longtime friend of Pastor John's. It's been a while since I've seen Pastor John, though. My name is Phil, and I am an ordained pastor. I'm not serving right now as a pastor anywhere. Right now, I'm working as a middle school teacher for a Christian school in Pataskala, Ohio. That's where I live, is in Pataskala, Ohio. Does anybody know where that's at? Okay. To get up there, get up there much, yeah, for ball games maybe. Who likes baseball? Yeah, all right. I love baseball. It's something that is important to me. I've been married to my wife Leah now for about 24 years, going on 25 this year. We have four beautiful kids. They're all growing up, though. Our oldest, she's a junior in college at Cedarville University. My only daughter, my oldest, and then I have three boys. My oldest daughter, her name's Rachel. My oldest boy, Joel, he's a junior in high school. And then my second to oldest boy, he's 14, his name's Luke. He's a freshman in high school. And then my youngest boy, Seth, he's a seventh grader. So I'm real proud of my kids and my family, who's proud of their family here. Amen. It's good to have a family, isn't it? Isn't it good to have family? Good to have a church family. And I can see you have a wonderful church family here. And I'm just delighted to be with you here this morning and worship with you. I'll go ahead and say it now. I know at the end of the service we're having a communion service. So in case I forget, I don't think I'll forget, but I'll just go ahead and say that now. At the close of my message, at the close of the invitation, there will be a communion service. So make sure you stick around for that as our leaders lead us in that this morning. We're going to be in Psalm. Again, we're going to be in the Psalms, the book of Psalms. We are opening scripture reading this morning was in the book of Psalms. We're going to be in Psalm chapter 23. Psalm 23 is where we're going to be this morning. Psalm 23. I say I'm from, give you a chance to turn there. I'm from, where right now I live in Pataskala, Ohio, but originally I grew up in southern Ohio. I grew up in Gallipolis, Ohio. Graduated the class in 93 and went to Yaya Academy High School down there, the Blue Devils. That was a long time ago, but lots of fond memories of that. So I love southern Ohio, and I kind of feel like as I'm coming down this way, I'm coming into, you know, my way, old way of life, and I always enjoy that. There's certainly a lot more I could share with you this morning about that, but we're here to exalt the Lord and to read His Word and to draw closer to Him. Psalm 23. I want to take us through this psalm this morning and think about this. Jesus, our shepherd. As we're looking at Psalm 23, we can see in this psalm something about Jesus. And He is the shepherd who satisfies. The late preacher, Adrian Rogers, who knows who that is? Adrian Rogers, yes, one of my favorite preachers. He describes Psalm 22, the psalm before this psalm, as a psalm about the saving shepherd. Psalm 24, just after Psalm 23, he describes that psalm. The title he gives to that psalm is a psalm about the sovereign shepherd. But squeezed in between these two psalms, we see this psalm about the satisfying shepherd. The shepherd who satisfies the soul. Would you stand with me as we read Psalm 23? I'm reading from the English Standard Version this morning, Psalm 23, a psalm of David. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Father, I thank You, Lord, for Your word. I praise You for You, O God. We come to You this morning seeking you, Father. We want to hear from you. We want to have open eyes, open ears to your word. And we recognize, though, that there are many things, many reasons why we don't have open eyes or open ears to your word. Sometimes it's sin. Oftentimes it's sin. Sometimes it's some heavy trial that we're going through. So many reasons why we might not be open to receiving your word, Father. Some grief that we're enduring, some pain that we're experiencing, Father. And we need your grace this morning, Lord. We need your help to hear you, O God. Sometimes we're blind. Sometimes we're dull of heart. We're deaf, Lord. We can't hear what you're saying to us. And Lord, I know that I've been that way often in my life. And Lord, I just come to you on behalf of us here, Lord, asking you, Father, that you would reveal yourself to us, that you would be exalted here, that Christ would be lifted up, but that we could draw near to you and join in with you and see how you are at work here, Father, in our midst. We know that you're always working because Jesus said that. He said, my Father is always working and I too am working. And Lord, we ask you to work in us. Work in us. Draw us to yourself. Help us to repent of any sin in our life. Help us to see you, the shepherd who satisfies. We praise you, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat. You could say this psalm, like many other portions of Scripture, is like a concentrated can of orange juice. Concentrated can of orange juice. Has anybody ever drank just a concentrated can of orange juice? Have you done that? Have you taken a spoon and just eaten the concentrated can? Have you done that? I've never done that before. But you could say that this Scripture, like many other Scriptures, is like that. But no one drinks normally, I should say, right? No one normally drinks a concentrated can of orange juice. You got to mix it down with a little bit of water. And in no way am I saying that we need to ever water down God's word. But all I'm really trying to say is that sometimes it's difficult to unpack everything that is there in God's word. And what we really find here is we're looking at Psalm 23. We discover that in this psalm, there is a great deal packed into it. A great deal that's packed into it. And you got to take it a little bit at a time. And oftentimes, Scripture as a whole can be that way. There's just a lot packed into it, and you got to take it a little bit at a time. There are two images that we can see here in Psalm 23 used to describe who our Lord is, who He is. He is a shepherd. We can see that in verses 1 through 4, who cares for his sheep. And he is a host in verses 5 through 6, who cares for his guest. It's a psalm written by David. David certainly identifies these two roles of our Lord and Savior and expresses them beautifully. Maybe because he understood himself from his own experience what it meant to be a shepherd and a provider. He would have known the responsibility that a shepherd has to feed their sheep. Bring them water, guard them, keep them close together, and lead them in the right way because he was a shepherd to his own father's sheep. We see that in 1 Samuel. If you've read about the life of David, you would know that about him. Also, when David was beginning to lead as a captain and a king for God's people in the army of Israel, he learned the value of being a host, a provider, and a protector. At times, as you read his life, we can see that he certainly fell short in his leadership. He had times of great sin. And he learned firsthand that the Lord is the shepherd, though, in his own life, who never fails and always satisfies his every need. In 1 Peter 5:4, to the leaders of the scattered church in what is now called modern-day Turkey, sometime between AD 62 through 64, the Apostle Peter called Jesus our chief shepherd. Jesus is our chief shepherd. And in difficulties and trials, we need a shepherd. We need a shepherd. We need someone there to help us in our greatest need. Fathers, dads, that's what we are to be in our homes. We are to be shepherds to our families. Many of you dads, you know that. Peter spoke about the need for elders or pastors in the church to be like shepherds to their flock and prove themselves to be examples over them. A faithful shepherd needs to be worthy to follow, worthy to emulate, worthy to imitate. They need to be able to relate with the sufferings of the ones they are leading. David was like that. David was I like reading about the life of David because here's a guy who's, you know, just been through life. A guy, as the scripture says, was after a man after God's own heart. And there's a lot we can admire about him in his life. We see in 1 Samuel 22:2, when he had to flee from Saul, that everyone, it says there in 1 Samuel 22:2, that everyone who was in distress and everyone who was in debt. Anybody in debt? Don't raise your hand. I relate to this guy. And everyone who was bitter, if you've been bitter or discontented, what did they do? They gathered to David. There was something about him. Here's a guy who's, you know, been through all of these difficulties in his life, but he still wanted to love the Lord. He wanted to seek the Lord. He wanted to draw near to the Lord. This isn't a perfect man. This isn't a man who never sinned, but this is a man who knew what it was like to live, but yet wanted to love the Lord. And as a leader, as leaders in the church, we need to be able to relate to the ones we are leading. And David related to those he led by becoming like them. This is really when we're looking at David's life, we look at Psalm 23, and we think about the life of David, it's really a picture of who Jesus is for us. Who Jesus is for us, though he never sinned. We see in 1 Peter 3:18 that Christ also suffered once for sins. Even though Jesus never sinned, he came to become like us in every way, except without sin, to relate with us, to go through what we're going through or ever will go through. It says in 1 Peter 3:18 that Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Only Jesus can be that shepherd. Leaders in our families and in the church, what we need to do, we need to be willing ourselves to follow in those steps of relating to those who we are leading and be a shepherd to them as well. But the concern for us is that we don't become all messed up ourselves as we are relating to others. In Galatians 6:1, Paul said, "Brothers and sisters, if someone is overtaken in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual, restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourselves so that you also won't be tempted." There's a story of a woman who went by a wall poster today that could very easily be a social media post that we're looking at, but she saw something that made her come back for a second look. The poster read this. It said, "This involvement with people is always a very delicate thing. It's always a very delicate thing. It requires real maturity to become involved and not get all messed up." I think that's good. And David, at times, you know, he'd get messed up and he would have to repent and acknowledge his sin. We can read Isaiah 53 and read about his repentance there for some sin in his life. And certainly when we get messed up, when we go down that wrong path, we can repent. And we have that grace and that privilege through Christ. But in the scriptures, David is a type of Christ. In other words, he in many ways points us to Christ because he went through what others went through. And we have that same opportunity to point others to Christ when we experience difficulty. 2 Corinthians 2:14 says, we are an aroma to others. 2 Corinthians 3:2 says, we are letters that people read. When they look at us, what do they see? David said this, the Lord is my shepherd. Is the Lord your shepherd? Do people see that in your life? We could ask the following question. When people look at our lives, do they hear us saying, the Lord is my shepherd or our shepherd? Or do they see someone who's trying to handle all their problems themselves? David was in many respects a good shepherd, but he sometimes failed. And he would have never have called himself the good shepherd, but Jesus is the good shepherd. John 10:14-15, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Ultimately, David's life and Psalms point us to Jesus, the better shepherd, who endured our greatest distress, but never lost faith, suffered our greatest debt, and never fell short, satisfies our greatest discontentment, and continues to supply our every need. He is the better shepherd. He is the better David, who satisfies all our needs. Is the Lord your shepherd? Is the Lord your shepherd? Can you make that boast this morning? There are at least three attitudes that we can see here in Psalm 23 that we can take note of when we are going through these times of distress, these times of debt, these times of discontentment in our lives to understand this question, to answer this question, is the Lord my shepherd? The first one we see is in verses 1 through 3. He says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. The first attitude we see in this psalm is this confession. We need to see the confession of the psalmist. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. I know that when I'm going through times of difficulty, that I often say that the Lord is my shepherd. When troubles come, and they will come, what can help us through it? What can help us through it is a true confession, this true confession that the Lord is your shepherd. A true confession sustains us. A true confession enables us to suffer through it because the trials will come. This confession, you could say, I like words that rhyme, but it's a confession of possession. You know, when I'm making this confession, what am I saying? It means I possess the Lord Jesus as my Savior. He's mine. He's mine. Can you say that about your life now, that Jesus, he's yours? Or that rather, you belong to Jesus. That you have this relationship with him. It's a confession of possession. David said, the Lord is my shepherd. This is like the best boast ever. It reminds me when I was a kid on the playground at school or somewhere else, maybe in the neighborhood playing. And I might have gotten to an argument over whose dad is the strongest, right? Over whose dad is the best, right? My dad can beat your dad up. Oh no, my dad can do this. My dad, right guys? Girls, you probably don't do that. It's my mom, right? I don't know. But, you know, this boast that we make, and when you know the Lord, you can say that. My dad, my Lord, he's going to win. Yeah, no matter what may come, the Lord is on my side. And that's the confession that we see here. David said, the Lord is my shepherd. It was a confession of faith in the Lord to always provide for him. David knew he had some successes He had some victories in his life, but they were not due to who he is. It was not due to his greatness. There are certainly, yes, times of pride in his life, times where he got all mixed up and forgot about that, I'm sure. And we can see that in his life. But overall, when you look at his life, you see that he understood that the Lord is his shepherd. He defeated the lion and the bear as a youth. He defeated Goliath as a young volunteer soldier. But he knew he didn't do any of that in his power. He remembered his successes were the result of God's blessing, God's presence in his life, God's power, and God's provision. Do you have that kind of confession this morning, that confession of possession? According to this psalm, how does the Lord bless us or provide for us? How do we know that he does that? What kind of confession of possession does David make here in regard to the provision of God in his life? He says in verse 1, I shall not want. I shall not want. What is he saying there? The Lord provides us a place of happiness. God gives us all that we truly need. Can you be happy as a Christian? Yes. By all means, be happy. Sometimes we get mixed up on that. I hear lots of preachers say God's not concerned about your happiness. I disagree. Now, not the happiness of this world. It's a different kind of happiness, right? It's a joy that will never leave us. It's true happiness. And it comes from the Lord. And God gives us a happiness that no one else can give. How else does he provide in this confession of possession that David makes? He says, he makes me lie down in green pastures. Praise the Lord. Spring's here, right? Spring's coming. Maybe looking out, the tulips that you've planted from years past are popping up, right? And you're seeing all of the wonderful, the lush things that are the daffodils, I guess, out in the woods have sprung. They're probably dying by now. I don't know. But we see the green, right, and the beauty that comes with spring. And David says here that the Lord makes me lie down in green pastures. Well, what is he saying here? He's saying the Lord provides a place for food. He gives us this place of provision. He makes me lie down in green pastures, Jesus said in John 6:35. How does this point us to Jesus? Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. He says in verse 2, he leads me beside still waters. The Lord provides a place to quench our thirst. Jesus said in John 6:35 also that whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Speaking to the Samaritan woman by the well, Jesus said, whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. He says in verse 3 of Psalm 23, David says, he restores my soul. He restores my soul. The Lord provides for us a place of healing. A place of healing. Psalm 147 verse 3 says, he heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. In verse 3, he says of Psalm 23, he leads me in the paths of righteousness. The Lord brings us into this place of blessedness. He provides because he is our shepherd. Jesus said in his Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5:6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Are you experiencing the blessing of the shepherd this morning? Is the Lord your shepherd? Do you have this confession of possession? Another attitude we can take note of in this psalm when we're going through times of distress, times of debt, times of discontentment, no matter what they are in our lives, that we need to see here is in verse 4. He says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. We've seen this confession. But now we need to see in verse 4 that there's this comfort that the psalmist has. The comfort of the psalmist. There are lots of things we can draw comfort from in the world and that we attempt to draw comfort from in the world. And we could name a few, but Psalm 23:4 says there are better things we can draw comfort from as we experience distress, as we experience debt, as we experience discontentment. There are better things we can draw comfort from when we are facing worse things, even things like death. An interesting allusion is made here in verse 4. He calls death a shadow. Death is a shadow. Notice the psalmist doesn't say, when I walk in the valley, what does he say here? He says, when I walk through the valley. When I walk through the valley. Charles Spurgeon said, Charles Spurgeon, that great preacher, said, death is not the house. Death is not the house, but the porch. Death is not the house, but the porch. Not the goal, but the passage. But the passage. I like that, that little picture there. Dr. Donald Barnhouse was a pastor. Between 1927 and 1960, he was the pastor of the 10th Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia. And he related this story about the death of his first wife. After he and his children had been to the funeral service, they were driving home. And as he was driving home, he said he was trying to think of some way to truthfully comfort his children. And just as he was thinking about that, a shadow from a large truck, swept over their car as the truck pulled out in front of them. He said, Children, would you rather be run over by a truck or by its shadow? The children said, the shadow, of course. That can't hurt us at all. Dr. Barnhouse said, well, do you know that about 2,000 years ago, the real truck of death ran over our Lord Jesus while he was on the cross in order that only its shadow would run over us. Death is a shadow. If the Lord is your shepherd, where are you drawing comfort from when faced with these things? Distress, debt, discontentment, or even death. What is the comfort of this psalmist in Psalm 23 when faced with these things? We see a couple of things for sure, not exhaustive. I'm sure we can see some more, but he says this, God's presence. One of the comforts that we can see of the psalmist here, David, is that he took comfort in God's presence. He says in verse 4, for you are with me. You are with me. When you're going through whatever you're going through right now in your life, we're all going through something. Can you say, the Lord is with me right now? You are with me. Yeah, I'm in this trial. I'm in this difficult time in my life, but you are with me. That's what the psalmist is saying here. What is it about the presence of God that brings us comfort when we are going through difficult times? Psalm 16:11 says, you make known to me the path of life. Here it is. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. Joy. This is how, you know, you can have that joy when you're going through the worst thing and other people look at your life, they look at your life, other people do, and they're like, how can you be happy right now when you're going through that? Well, I have the Lord who is with me. I have the Lord. I know He's my Savior. I know that Jesus came and died on the cross for my sins. I have that comfort, that assurance, that belief, that faith in my heart. I know Jesus is my God. He is my Savior. Can you say that this morning through whatever you're going through? He had the presence of God in his life. And that was his comfort. He also had God's discipline. He had God's discipline in his life. He likes discipline. I don't necessarily enjoy it myself. There's all kinds of discipline. There's punitive discipline, and we hate that, right? Who wants to be punished? Boys, love it? No. Corrective discipline. Maybe you're on the baseball field. You know you made an error. You learn from it. You don't throw a fit, right? You learn from it. You move on. Short memory, right? Make the corrections. Then there is formative discipline. There's that kind of discipline. It shapes you. Parents, that's what we aim for. We're shaping our children, hopefully. We don't want... Did any parent here love to punish their children? Don't do it. Raise your hand, right? I don't. I mean, we hate that. If we love our kids, we don't enjoy punishing our kids. That's what we're trying to avoid, right? We're trying to shape them, correct them out of love for them. But there's discipline. That we receive, that we give to our children, and that God gives to us. And the good thing about discipline is this, is if we are being disciplined by God, what does that tell us? That He loves us, right? That we belong to Him. That He cares enough to go out of His way to correct us and to discipline us. God's discipline brings us comfort. He says in verse 4, "Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." David had learned the comfort of God's discipline in his life. I like how the NLT translates this verse. It says, "Your rod and staff protect and comfort me." We can't have the protection of God apart from discipline. We've seen the confession of the psalmist. And we've seen the comfort of the psalmist. But there's another attitude of the psalmist that we can see here in Psalm 23. When faced with trouble and difficulties that we need to get, and we can see that here in verses 5 through 6, he says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Not only do we see the confession of the psalmist and the comfort of the psalmist, but we can also see the confidence of the psalmist. It's important to have confidence during trouble. Where is your confidence? We see where the psalmist's confidence is at. He says, "The Lord prepares for him a table in the presence of his enemies." He says, "The Lord anoints his head with oil and that his cup overflows." What he's saying here is that God has called us to rest, even if there's a war going on. God has called us to rest in him. And let him fight our battles. We can draw confidence from the fact that he will fight our battles. Our confidence of the psalmist that we see here, and our confidence that we need to take from this, is that God will fight our battles. He will do for us what we cannot do for ourselves, which is really everything. And he says to us, "Sit down, eat, drink this. I've got it. I've got it." Do you have that confidence this morning? Now, this isn't some idle rest like sitting around guys playing video games and or just watching some TV and not taking responsibility in your life and just not doing nothing. That's not what we're talking about here. Certainly, we want to be seeking the Lord and pursuing Him and saturating ourselves with the Word of God and surrounding ourselves with godly things. But When we are doing that, what we are doing is we are sitting down before the Lord and we are resting in His provision, taking in what He gives to us. Jesus said in Matthew 11, 28, He said, come to me, all who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Where are you drawing confidence from? Again, I believe it. I refer to Adrian Rogers a couple times. I like to listen to him sometimes. So I believe it was Adrian Rogers who I heard explain that when a guest in Middle Eastern culture would come to visit in these times that scripture was written, when a guest in Middle Eastern culture would come to visit and maybe sit down for meal, that they'd know if their host wanted them to stay by how much their host would refill their cup at the meal. By how much their host would, refill their cup at the meal. And if their host only filled it halfway up, that meant, well, thanks for visiting, but you'll need to go now. You'll just need to go. We're done. But if they kept pouring, it meant this. Please stay. Please stay. Please stay. And here's what the Lord does for us. That's what He's doing. He's pouring into the cup, saying, please stay. David says, my cup overflows. I know I'm welcome here. You're calling me to please stay. His confidence is in the shepherd who satisfies. The shepherd who says, please stay. He says in verse 6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I know you're going to be taking communion this morning. And what I think of is this, is when I'm asking these questions, when we're looking at Psalm 23, we think about these points in regard to the shepherd who satisfies. Where is your confession? Where is your confidence? Where is your comfort and where is your confidence? Are you drawing confidence from the fact that Jesus is your shepherd? Are you drawing confidence from the fact that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, that He came to take your place and do for you what you can't do for yourself? Do you have this confession of possession where you could say, Jesus is my Lord? Maybe there's some sin in your life that you know you've come to that point in your life. You've trusted Jesus to be your Savior and Lord. You've acknowledged that Jesus is God, that He is your Savior and Lord. You've come to that point in your life, but maybe there's some sin in your life that has taken you off track, that has led you astray, and now you're not what you need to be in fellowship with the Lord. And you may feel like, I don't even think I could sit down at that table with the Lord right now and do what He's telling me to do. Drink up, eat, have fellowship with me. And you may not believe or feel that He could even forgive you for some sin in your life. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It doesn't say, well, unless you did that. It doesn't say that. It says, if we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Maybe you've had that confession of faith, but you don't feel like you have that confession of faith now. The Lord's inviting you this morning to turn from your sin, to repent, to never visit it again, to turn your back on that sin and to follow Him. To turn away from it and follow Him, but to sit at His table and let Him do what only He can do for you, which is enable you to repent of that sin. He says, come, eat. We're going to have the praise team come forward right now. And I want to invite you to examine your own hearts this morning. And think about where you are with the Lord. The scripture encourages us not to take of the Lord's Supper unworthily. And what that's saying is that if we are aware of some sin in our life, something that we need to confess, we need to acknowledge it. We need to acknowledge that sin in our life. I'm not going to tell you that you have to come down forward to acknowledge your sin before the Lord. You can do that right where you're at, where you're seated. You can tell the Lord, Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. I know, Lord, that I've not been living in a way that's pleasing to you, Lord. And I want to turn from my sin. Please help me to do that. You can do that right now, this morning, right where you're at. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter how young you are, no matter how old you are, you can say to Jesus, I know I'm a sinner and that you are God and that Jesus, you died on the cross for my sins. You rose from the dead. I believe you did that to help me to turn from my sin and to forgive me of it. That's what you can do this morning, right there in your seat. And I want to invite you to do that right now with every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand or anything. I'm just going to ask you to come before the Lord and say to the Lord right now, Lord, you know my sin. Lord, you know my sin. You know where I'm at right now. Please help me to repent of it. Lord, I know that what you did on the cross for me is the one and only payment for my sin. Jesus, I believe in you. Please forgive me. Please help me to repent. Please help me to live for you, Lord, today and tomorrow and the rest of my days, so that I can dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lord, I want to be with you. I want to sit at your table. If that's you this morning, I just want to encourage you to know that if you've come to the Lord with that confession of faith, you have this assurance. You're forgiven. And you're His. If that's you this morning. And that you can have this liberty of participating in this ordinance. This ordinance of the Lord's Supper that we will take hereafter we sing these songs. Father, I praise you and thank you. I thank you for every soul here, every person here, Lord, that's here, for every family that's here, Father. I thank you, O God, for your Holy Spirit who is at work right now in the hearts of every person here. Thank you, Lord, that you're at work in my heart, that you're working, Lord, here to bring about repentance and faith in your Son Christ, that you are going to do a mighty thing here, O God, at New Lexington Baptist Church in New Lex, Ohio. Lord, I pray for every person here, Lord, that you would just encourage them, ignite in them, Lord, a fire for you, Lord, to live for you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Would you stand as we sing these songs?
There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God, a place where sin cannot molest, near to the heart of God. Bless three. near to the heart of God. Oh, Jesus, blessed Redeemer, sent from the heart of God. Hold us to wait before thee, near to the heart of God.
Speak this morning and be a part of your worship. I want to close this in a word of prayer and then invite our leaders to lead us in a time of communion. Father, we just praise you and thank you, Lord, for this opportunity, Lord, to come into your house and to worship you, Lord. And as we continue to worship you, Lord, in spirit and truth, Lord, I just pray that you would help us to go from here, Lord, with renewed hearts and hearts that just honor you. And Lord, we pray that you would be exalted right now as we are participating in the Lord's Supper. In Jesus' name, amen.